RPG 101. Today, we're going to talk about equipment. Well, as any adventurer knows, to get the job done, you need the right stuff to do it with. If you need to kill something, you obviously need a weapon. If you need to open a door, you need tools. So, where do you get these things? Well, you buy them before you leave town. Now, for the most part, equipment buying is a simple process. You get a certain amount of gold, you have a list of stuff, and you pair what you want with how much gold it costs, just like you're going to the grocery store to get a loaf of bread. The difference is, there are some things that you actually start the game with. For example, you always start the game with at least one pair of traveling clothes. These are things that are just given to you outright. You don't have to pay for your clothing, you don't start the game out in your skivvies. And generally speaking, most adventurers will assume that they have at least one change of clothes in their pack. The things that you have to buy are generally your armor, your weapons, class tools, class components for your spells, things of that nature. Now, some DMs, myself included, will actually provide some of these things for you. Class tools like thieving tools, holy symbols, holly, things of that nature, you're going to start off with. You're not going to have a wizard who doesn't have a level 1 wizard without a spell component pouch or a spell book, because it's generally assumed, at least in my games, that before you're allowed to go off on your own without your master, you're going to have written a spell book with your basic spells in it. You're going to have a pouch with your spell components in it. If you're a cleric, if you're an ordained cleric, you're not going to leave the church without your holy symbol, whether it be on your vestments or an actual medallion. If you're a paladin, the same goes for you. You're not leaving the church without some visible symbol of your faith. So, things of that nature, I generally give you when you start, along with a backpack, rope, and a light source of some sort. These are what I call the starting packs. So, what do you need to buy if you get one of these basic starter kits? Well, the first thing anybody should buy is some sort of armor. Now, I'm going to be doing this out of the 4th edition D&D Player's Handbook, so I don't misspeak. But generally, in 4th edition, armor was separated into several different classes. You have the light armor and heavy armor. Whereas in 3rd edition, you had light, medium, and heavy. Now, light armor's broken down even further. You have cloth armor, leather armor, and hide armor. Now, for the most part, wizards and sorcerers are going to be wearing cloth armor. This was actually one of the things that I liked about 4th edition. It gave wizards and sorcerers an option for armor that would not interfere with their spellcasting, because they would be wearing robes, so obviously the robes are their armor. And the basic cloth armor didn't really give you much of an armor bonus, but it didn't give you an enhancement bonus, but it didn't interfere with your speed, didn't interfere with your spellcasting, and it only cost you 1 gold piece. Now, different armors like Feyweave and Starweave, they would be something special that had to be crafted, therefore the price would be generally set by the merchant making it, and of course by the DM who's playing the merchant. Now, leather armor is a really good choice for rogues and bards who want to have the mobility but also want to have a little bit of extra stopping power to their armor. Leather armor in 4th edition cost 25 gold pieces and gave you +2 to your armor class, which means if that's the only armor you add that to your dex bonus, whatever it may be, and the standard 10 that all classes get as armor, and that would give you your total armor class. Now, chainmail used to be considered medium armor. But in 4th edition, it's considered heavy armor. It gives you a +6 to your armor bonus and generally costs around 40 gold pieces. Now, on the other hand, Because it gives you such a high bonus to your armor, it obviously has some penalties to it. It has a speed penalty of 1 square and a check penalty of 1, which means you move 1 square or 5 feet slower. Now, what does this mean? Well, in 4th edition, speed wasn't measured in feet, it was measured in squares, because it was assumed all players in 4th edition would be using a battle grid. Battle grid is a 1x1-inch square that your character occupies, which represents a 5x5-foot, 5-foot by 5-foot section of space. This is the space that your character occupies and can affect without having to move. In 4th edition, this is represented by squares. You can move this many squares in a round. Now, in 3rd edition and earlier editions, it was represented by feet, which means if you had a top speed of 30, you can move 30 feet in a round without running, without having to hustle. In 4th edition, they simplified it down a little bit, which is what a lot of people who didn't like 4th edition disagreed with. There was a lot of oversimplification of a lot of the rules. But in essence, it means you can move 1 square fewer in a round, and if you do anything that requires a check, that has a check penalty, like swimming, climbing, casting a spell, you receive a -1 penalty to that check. Now, what most people consider when they think of armor, they think of the giant boilerplates that knights would wear. That's included in this as well, as it's called plate mail, and it is heavy armor. Now, in 4th edition, you had the basic plate mail.
And no brains. You can't even put a man's armor on him properly.
You're too fat for your armor.
Fat? Fat, is it? Is that how you speak to your king?
Oh, it's funny, is it?
No, Your Grace.
No? You don't like the hand's joke?
It's ushering the poor boy.
You heard the hand. The king's too fat for his armor. Go find the breastplate stretcher! Now!
The breastplate stretcher.
How long before he figures it out?
Which gave you a +8 to your armor bonus, cost 50 gold for the full plate, and it would give you a -1 speed and -2 check penalty, which means if you're wearing full plate and you go overboard, you're going to have a hard time swimming. Which is why a lot of fighters, if they know they're going to go on a boat, they take their plate mail off and wear something a little lighter that's easier to swim in. Now, weapons are generally split into a couple of different categories. Light weapons, simple weapons, martial weapons. And each of these has a specific category for a reason. Simple weapons are things like clubs, quarterstaffs, daggers, and anything that any person on the street would know how to use. Many of these are things that people have for different purposes. Like quarterstaffs often start off as walking sticks. A club is basically a stick you can find it anywhere. It's a big, heavy stick that you beat people over the head with. As such, clubs are actually the only weapon in the game that are free. Quarterstaffs are generally inexpensive, costing a couple of gold pieces apiece. Daggers cost around 5 gold pieces. And then you get into martial weapons. Now, martial weapons are weapons that you actually need a little bit of training to use. Hence, martial, because it's usually used by the militias and the armies. Martial weapons are things like long swords, short swords, broad swords, great swords, rapiers, and things of that nature. Pole arms are in this as well, as are maces, warhammers, or exotic weapons. Exotic weapons actually have their own category, but they are part of a martial thing because they do require training to use them. Ranged weapons are also split into this as well, but most ranged weapons are generally things like bows, long bows, short bows, crossbows, hand crossbows, slings, darts, and shuriken. These are things that don't generally require a lot of use, because almost every peasant would have a bow and arrow to go hunting with. Bows cost a little bit of money, and you do have to buy the ammunition separate, which is a good thing in most schools, but at the same time, they also have a rule that most ammunition is destroyed when you use it, so generally, every time you fire an arrow, you don't get the arrow back. You have to go buy new arrows the next time you're available, or steal them from other enemies, but they may not be as high a quality or the right length. Generally speaking, ammunition for slings, yeah, sling bullets are much more accurate and a little bit more deadly, but you're going to find pebbles everywhere, especially if you're in a dungeon that's a couple of decades old. You're going to have little tiny stones everywhere. Exotic weapons are weapons that are not commonly found in most armies. Things like spiked chains. You don't see an entire squadron of soldiers walking around with barbed chains in their hands. Spiked chains are essentially long lengths of chains with sharpened barbs on the ends and on some of the outer links that can be used to attack foes both directly in front of you and a little ways away from you. But because of the nature of the weapon, it is difficult to use and requires extreme extensive training, which makes it an exotic weapon. Now, with that being said, some exotic weapons are given to some races as a martial weapon. For example, Dwarven Urgosh is listed on the exotic weapons table in most D&D handbooks. But it is also known that if a dwarf chooses to use the Dwarven Urgosh, it is considered a martial weapon for dwarves, because it is standard in their armories. The same with the gnome battle picks. Any other race uses it, they have to be trained with it, which makes it an exotic weapon, but gnomes, it's part of their standard arsenal. They know how it's used, they know how it works. Weapons are even further separated into different categories, besides simple, martial, and exotic. They can be classified down into light and heavy, one-handed and two-handed, and light one-hand and heavy one-hand. Now, that may sound a little complicated, but it's really easy to understand. Take a rapier, for instance. A rapier is a light, one-handed weapon. It has a thin blade and is obviously designed more for piercing and stabbing than for cutting across bodies and blocking most other blows. Rapiers are seen in heavy use in a lot of places by duelists and by gentlemen in more Renaissance-type campaign settings. If you want to see just how versatile a rapier is, any Three Musketeer movie or any movie set in that time period is more than enough footage for you to see. I especially recommend the one with Christian Slater and Kiefer Sutherland as opposed to some of the more recent ones. Now, broadswords or longswords. Longswords are a special case. Technically, they are a one-handed weapon, but some, like this one, actually has a long enough handle for both hands to grip it. It is a rule that you can grip a longsword with two hands for an extra one-half of your attack damage. Now, there are other swords that are neither two-handed swords nor long swords. This one falls more into that category. They're called bastard swords, or hand-and-a-half swords, because generally speaking, there's enough room for one hand and just a little bit extra. Those weapons deal a little bit extra damage, and they are considered heavy one-handed weapons. Sometimes they can be put into the classification as two-handed weapons or exotic weapons, depending on the exact type. Okay, now I've piqued some people's interests. We've shown you the rapier, we've shown you the longsword, but what about that iconic sword in most samurai movies, the katana? Well, the katana, game rules, is considered to be a bastard sword because it is a sword that can be used one-handed or two-handed. It's also considered in most games, in some game systems, as an exotic weapon, as it is from a foreign country in most settings. However, any bastard sword can be considered to be a katana for roleplay purposes. That, of course, has to be mentioned and talked over with your DM. And you have to give up the proper payments for it. So, what are these going to cost you? Well, referring to the 4th edition handbook again, a longsword generally is going to cost you around 15 gold pieces to purchase. Not bad, considering the amount of craftsmanship that has to go into it to make sure it doesn't shatter upon its first contact with something. The bastard sword, 30 gold pieces. 25 gold pieces for a rapier. Now, what about a two-handed sword? A great sword? Well, that's going to cost you 30 gold pieces as well. Now, how does all this factor in? Well, basically speaking, you're going to start off with a limited amount of gold. And as I've just shown you, each thing has a substantial gold cost. Now, how much gold you start off with is randomized, because each class gets a die roll plus, if you're starting at first level, each class gets a die roll times 10 to determine how much gold they have, and not every person is going to get the same amount of gold as another person playing the same class. Now, there is an average gold starting amount, and some books will actually have that in the table, as well as the randomized gold. But generally speaking, you're not going to have money to get everything you want. You're going to have to be very frugal about it. You're going to have to be very careful. You know, you may want to have the Fey Weave cloth armor, but if it costs 200 gold and you only have 205 pieces of gold, you know, that's kind of straining your funds there, and you won't really be able to get a really good weapon, let alone some of the other things you may need. So, generally speaking, at first level, most players buy the best piece of equipment they can afford that doesn't break their bank. Now, one thing that I have seen that 3rd edition did slightly better than 4th edition is the concept of masterwork armor and weapons. Now, what this is exquisite armor, which is considered to be higher grade than standard weapons. Let's say a masterwork dagger is made out of the finest steel, whereas a common dagger may just be made out of normal steel or even high-quality iron. Now, while this does increase their value as far as weapons, because they can be enchanted at a later time, it does significantly increase their gold costs. Most masterwork weapons in 3rd edition cost an additional 100 gold pieces, plus what the standard quality weapon would cost. Now, while these are good purchases for later on, because they do give you bonuses, masterwork armor is generally considered to be one weight class lighter, has reduced check penalties, and masterwork weapons are generally slightly better on the attack as far as allowing you bonuses. And beyond that, they can be enchanted with permanent effects. However, most starting characters are not going to be able to afford that, especially if their starting gold is something like 75 pieces of gold. You know, you got to get armor, you got to get at least one weapon, and you might have to get other things that pique your interest, because there is more than just armor and weapons in the equipment guides. There are things like climbing kits, disguise kits, healing kits. There are caltrops, which are the spikes that you throw on the ground so in such a way that no matter what way they land, there's always at least one sharp edge pointing up. There are collapsible ladders, collapsible poles, chests, manacles, spyglasses, alchemy kits, all sorts of things are found in the equipment section of these books, and they all cost money. Now, not all of these things are required. It may just be that your character has a passion for staring at the stars at night, so he buys a spyglass, and just at the end of the evening, while resting, he gazes at the stars, or maybe you're an aspiring alchemist and you carry a little alchemy kit with you wherever you go to brew healing potions and poultices. Or perhaps you're a bounty hunter, a lawgiver. You carry manacles for when you find that elusive bounty that's been running from you for weeks. You know, all of these things can go into what the makeup of your character. But, like I said, they cost gold. So how do you determine how much gold you start off with? Well, that depends on your system that you're playing. In 4th edition D&D, you start off with a flat 100 gold pieces, regardless of class. Fair, simple, and a relatively average amount of gold. Now, in 3.5, you rolled a random amount for each class. For example, barbarians got 4d4 times 10 gold pieces with an average of 100 gold pieces. Druids would only roll 2d4 times 10, which would average out to about 50 gold pieces. So, depending on what class you are, would also determine how much gold you got. Now, are you going to want to spend all your gold? Not necessarily. Whenever I play a character, I like to hold back about 10 to 15 gold pieces worth of coins in various denominations to pay for things like lodging, meals, food, and the occasional bribe. How does this work out? Well, denominations of coins in D&D and Pathfinder, the standard is the gold coin. However, there are smaller and larger denominations of coins. The smallest coin you're going to be able to find is a copper piece. And the standard setup is 10 pieces of copper equals one piece of silver. And 10 pieces of silver will equal one piece of gold. 10 pieces of gold will equal one piece of platinum. Each of these are about the size, somewhere between between a quarter and a half dollar in size. Now, while generally speaking, a lot of people don't consider the weight of coins into their weight allowances if they track weight, some people actually do, and they like keeping track of that because while individual coins aren't really all that heavy, they do tend to weigh a lot in aggregate. Just look for yourself. If you ever get a roll of quarters, a quarter by itself is not all that heavy, but a roll of quarters is quite substantial. That's 40 coins, and it weighs a good amount of weight. And can, if you imagine expanding that out to 100 quarters, it's understandable why some people want to keep track of this. However, many towns and adventure posts will have places where you can exchange your coins out for larger and smaller denominations. Like I said, I like to keep around 10 to 15 gold pieces, most of it in silver with a handful of coppers and golds, because there are some services that will cost me a gold piece and there are some services that will cost me a copper. I'd like to be able to have the combined stuff. And most shops, if they have a set price in silver or copper and you pay them with a larger denomination coin, they will give you the change. Some people also like to carry the occasional gemstone around. That, you know, a single ruby the size of a baby potato could cost a couple of hundred gold pieces, or even into the hundreds of platinum pieces, depending on the rarity and quality. And it takes up no more room than any other thing you might carry in your pocket or a belt pouch, and it weighs less than the equivalent amount of coinage. And when you get to a town or a trading post, you can trade that out for a letter of credit, which is another way some people carry their monetary funds around. Or tally books. They'll deposit their coins into a central trust bank of some sort, and they will give them an account book or a tally book, which you hand to the people you're buying your equipment from. They would write the cost down, and you would give them the voucher. The voucher would be sent to the bank, and the bank would pay them the owed money in coinage. All of these are options that any person can play into the game. So let's look at a breakdown of purchasing equipment. I have here the rough list of a character I built a little while ago for a friend's campaign. I was playing a fighter, And we used the standard Pathfinder method of randomly rolling your gold, and I lucked into having 240 gold pieces. So what did I get for 240 gold? Well, for 240 gold, I got two short swords, a short bow, three daggers, a throwing axe, studded leather armor, a large healer's kit, several belt pouches, a large tent, an extra pack, 40 arrows, two bags of caltrops, and 15 shurikens. Now, that dropped me all the way down to 80 gold pieces. So, I still have quite a bit of money left, but I also spent the money wisely, because the concept I was going for is this is a character who I never wanted to stop moving in combat. I wanted him to be just as able in forests and thick jungles as he is on plains and mountaintops, inside dungeons. I was basically going for a dervish type thing where he never stopped moving, and even if he had to leave a weapon in his opponent, he had another weapon he could pull. I also had a walking stick, which basically I was going to use as a modified club, because something else I like to do when I build fighters is I like to have at least one of each type of damage. Because not all monsters will take damage from the same weapon. Skeletons, for instance, if you hit them with a piercing weapon like a rapier, they're just going to kind of sit there and... Whereas you hit them with a club, you're shattering stuff. Same thing for zombies. You stab them or you beat them, they're not really going to feel a lot, but if you cut them apart, they're going to stop moving.
Now stand aside, worthy adversary.
'Tis but a scratch.
A scratch? Your arm's off.
No, it isn't.
Well, what's that then?
I've heard worse.
What am I going to do with the other 80 gold pieces? Well, like I said, I'm going to break it into several different currencies and use that to pay for lodgings, travel, food, drink, fine equipment if I need to replace arrows and things of that nature. So, you know, it's good to have a little cash in hand, or in pouch in this case. Now that you've got a basic look at equipment and you want to know more, it's easy to find this stuff. You know, if you have Player's Handbook, there's an entire chapter dedicated to equipment, and it's not just weapons and armor. If you don't have a Player's Handbook, but you know somebody who does, ask to borrow it for a couple of minutes. Just leaf through the pages. Also, a lot of gaming systems put their quick start guides out for free. If you go to drivethroughrpg.com, you can find any number of quick start guides, which includes basic weapons, basic armor, basic classes, to basically get you started in these games as soon as possible. And also, there's probably, if you go Google D&D 4th edition equipment lists, there's probably any number of places that have these out there. So, equipment, it's the best way to gear out your party, because not every door can be kicked down by the barbarian. So, there we have it, RPG 101. Join us next time, where we'll start doing the class overview for real this time. And we start off with the barbarian.
Ain't it cool?